Is this your paramour? He wears both his van braces, unmarried and eligible.
I'm flattered, ladies, but I'm not a noble. I'm a knight of the warrior caste.
Warrior caste isn't bad.
Tully, we didn't pay gold for these permits to take warrior caste.
All around me are familiar faces.
Hello and welcome back to the Steam Pilgrimage and part 3 in this series on the storytelling techniques of video games. If you want to watch the previous installments, there's a link on the screen right now. Last time we focused on BioShock's themes of choice and predetermination through the lens of science fiction. Through its mostly linear story, BioShock played with the idea of player choice and agency, subverting the belief that we as players actually affect the outcome of video game narratives. But that was in a linear action-adventure game. How much influence over the direction of a story can be ceded to the player in a sprawling, open-ended role-playing game? Enter BioWare, the studio that, for better or worse, changed how character-driven RPGs, with the emphasis on the or, would be developed for years to come. In 2003, BioWare released Knights of the Old Republic, an action RPG set in the Star Wars universe. Knights of the Old Republic, or KOTOR for short, would pioneer a number of features that are commonplace today, like offering morally grey decisions to the player with far-reaching unknown consequences, and recording these choices over the course of multiple games. These features are now a staple of BioWare's approach to role-playing, and became the inspiration for the rise of the moral choice and karma systems that were all the rage in the late 2000s and early 2010s, as well as the entire basis for the telltale episodic storytelling genre. BioWare themselves developed this type of gameplay system into its two largest franchises, Mass Effect and Dragon Age. However, where Mass Effect and the Dragon Age sequels all featured voice protagonists, making it feel more like you're embodying an established character, Dragon Age Origins was the last of the old-school BioWare games, defined by dialogue options with a murky intent behind what each option means, and often without a clear right or wrong answer. A silent protagonist allows the player to better inhabit their role and make the character their own. Which means when you need to make choices in the game, you feel the weight of the consequences. And this game is all about choice and consequence, with this idea being pushed regularly throughout the game. As you progress, you will need to make harsh decisions about who lives and who dies. Do you side with the most effective ally or the morally correct one? How far will you go to achieve your goal, and how will your resolve as well as your own biases and outlook affect your choices? But most importantly, how deep do these decisions go, and how much of an effect can you truly have on the world of Theodis and the threat of the Blight? In games, there are two types of decisions. The moral dilemmas don't really have a wide-reaching effect other than maybe annoying your party members, but they are crucial for the role-playing aspect of your character. The second are plot decisions. Do we go with plan A or plan B? Who do I send on this suicide mission, etc., etc.? These are just as important as the moral decisions, as they make the world you inhabit feel real and that you're not being railroaded. This gives the player agency and separates them from a mere spectator in the narrative. So, how does Dragon Age Origins stack up when it comes to these two factors? Let's go through the plot point by point and examine all of the tough choices you have to make at each crossroad we come to. Deep below the land of Theodis, amongst the winding tunnels of the deep roads, the darkspawn search endlessly for a slumbering archdemon. No one knows what drives them in their hunt, but once found, the archdemon will lead the darkspawn in a blight against the people of the surface. Some claim this to be a punishment for the sins of the past, others think it is the corruption of the old gods that brings forth the blight. Whatever the cause, as a member of the Grey Wardens, it is your job to find the newest archdemon, and through your choices and decisions, end this blight before it can truly begin. After the opening cutscene, giving you the basic exposition about the Darkspawn and the Blight, we're given our first major choice in how the game plays out. You choose a gender, race, class, and background. All of these have an effect on how characters treat you, and in the case of backgrounds, it decides which of the six unique origin tutorial missions you'll start the game playing. These are massive 1 to 2 hour chunks of gameplay that are unique to each background and can give very different perspectives on the world for your character. Two of your choices have you start in the main city of Denerim, but from drastically different societal positions. With the human noble background, you live in the lap of luxury on the estate of a local Arl. Or you could experience life in the Denerim Elven Alienage, a segregated ghetto where the elven population lives in squalor. There's also the Dalish Elves, who are elves who still live in the wild and try to continue on the traditions of their people from before they were subjugated by humans. The most unique opening has to be the Circle Mage opening. This is the only opening I played through fully, other than the one I chose to continue with for the entire playthrough. Open only to either humans or elves, but closed to dwarves due to their aversion to magic, the Circle Mage origin is tied to your class choice, and is the only background available if you want to play as a mage. Mages in Dragon Age draw their power from their connection to the Fade, which is a magical realm full of demons. Because of this connection, mages are susceptible to demonic possession, and as such, any person found to have innate magical abilities is sent to the Circle as a child. Here they are taught to control their power under the watchful eye of the Templars, an order of knights trained to slay rogue mages. Mages that have gone rogue. Hybrid classes aren't a thing in this game. The last two origins are for the Dwarven races, and they take place in the Dwarven city of Orzammar. Your choices for backgrounds are a casteless dwarf commoner living in Dusttown making money as a petty criminal, or the favorite child of the current Dwarven king, never passing up an opportunity to be treated like royalty, and being a basic ass bitch, I decided to go for a classic sword and board dwarf noble warrior. Dwarves in Dragon Age live under a caste system, with the lowest of the low having no family name and never having their deeds recorded in the annals of history. The highborn, on the other hand, that's me, are treated with reverence, and their family are usually elevated to that status after producing a paragon, a great hero of sorts. The name of the paragon that founded this particular house, his name is
Hadouken!
I also decided to play as a woman, as I thought living in this feudal, European-esque setting might have interesting consequences for females compared to males. Finally, after picking a suitably feminine version of my name, Dan Ella was ready to begin her journey. For this particular origin, you begin the story on the eve of your first military excursion as a commander for your father's army. You're first introduced to your manservant, Gorim, who informs you to meet your father and receive your orders. Straight out the front door, you're presented with the first of many moral quandaries that you use as a sort of whetstone to sharpen your personality and begin to inhabit the role of a character. A scholar is arguing with a highborn dwarf over some passages he wants to write, which casts the dwarf's family in a not so good light. The question is simple. Is the truth more important than honor? I personally think that the truth matters more, so naturally, being a noble myself, I have the man executed for his hubris. There's no real repercussions for this other than my own moral sense of right and wrong either being upheld or violated, but I just made a decision about who my character is. After being a total badass and winning the tournament being held in my honor, in a totally fair fight that definitely wasn't compromised due to my station in life, I'm brought before the council to receive my assignment. Going into the deep roads and finding the lost shield of the Paragon,
Hadouken!
This meeting is also being attended by a Grey Warden named Duncan, looking for recruits to help fight the Blight. Right before I go to give my speech, however, another council person asks me to give my support to a cause he's campaigning for. His wife's brother is a surface dwarf. Under Orzammar law, any dwarf that goes to the surface can never come back underground to Orzammar. He wants the law changed to allow a path to reintegration, as these surface dwarves are actually crucial for trade between Orzammar and other cities, but they are essentially shunned for their service. Again, another choice with no real in-game consequence, but what these choices are doing is tempering you for the future. When a moral dilemma does present itself that will have real consequences, you can draw inspiration from your previous decisions rather than asking yourself what kind of character you are in the heat of the moment. I decide to help and give a little speech about letting the surface cast back in. After the meeting, you meet your older brother Trian, next in line for the throne, and your younger brother Balin. Balin informs you that Trian is planning to murder you, as there are rumors that the council might want to name you king instead of him, even though being the oldest, it is his birthright. I decided I don't really like this plan and I plan to get the jump on him. So you go on your mission, but when you get to the
Hadouken!
You find a group of mercenaries waiting for you who seem to have a very similar goal in mind. When you defeat them, you find a house
Hadouken!
Signet ring on them, the very same ring needed to open the
Hadouken!
Crypt. Seemingly confirming your suspicions about your brother, you head back, only to be confronted by Treon as you try to leave the Deep Roads. You're forced to kill your brother in self-defense, but the contents of the heated exchange between you two doesn't quite add up. Enter stage left this asshole, Baelin, along with the King's men who orchestrated this whole thing to kill one of you and frame the other, leaving the throne open for himself. Not truly believing you could have murdered your brother, but with no evidence to exonerate you, you are banished to the Deep Roads to fight Darkspawn until they eventually overwhelm you. But my Bay Garum has a solution for me. If I can find the Grey Wardens before they leave, there's a chance they might conscript me into their ranks and I can live. And oh look, I do just that. Whew, what a relief. Duncan takes you to Ostagar, an old defensive position where the Wardens plan to nip the entire Blight in the bud with a show of force. King Kaelin is adamant that this isn't even a true Blight, and a plan is made to engage the main horde head-on and have Terran Loghain, the King's General, flank the enemy from the side. But first we have to go through the Joining, a ritual that makes you into a Grey Warden. You're also asked to go get some old treaties that promise loyalty to the Grey Wardens from each of the major cities in Ferelden. Before leaving though, the Kennel Master asks if I can find some rare flowers in the wild to cure a Mabari hound, and oh, who's a good buff? Of course I'll help you, look at him, who could say no to that face? While out in the wilds, you also run into Flemeth, the famous Witch of the Wilds, and her daughter, Morrig. She gives you the treaties that she says she's been protecting since the magic seal wore off. Back at the camp, you undergo the fairly painless ritual by drinking some Darkspawn blood. Hey, 1 out of 3 is not bad. This gives you super Darkspawn sensing abilities and the ability to kill an archdemon. I also bring the flowers to the Kennel Master, and the good boy is feeling much better. Yes, he is. Finally, with all the plans laid out, the moment of truth approaches. Kaelin and Duncan lead the charge as you make your way to the beacon to signal the flanking attack with another Grey Warden, Alistair. Comedy relief extraordinaire and professional doormat. He is basically the Chandler Bing of fantasy heroes. You manage to defeat the Darkspawn in the tower and light the beacon, but at the last moment, Loghain pulls his men out and retreats. This betrayal leads to a catastrophic defeat and the death of both Kaelin and Duncan. Thankfully, you and Alistair are deus ex machinaed right out of there by Flemeth. Flemeth doesn't seem like the altruistic type, but she tells you to go out and rally an army using the treaties that you found, and tells Morrigan to go with you. Finally, the story can truly begin as you go out into the world with your permanent companions. First stop is the nearby village of Lothering. But on the way, who do we run into but it's our best boy Fido, yes it is! I then try to get a mod to work that allows me to have my dog companion and 3 humans, but it doesn't, so I just never use him again or remember that he exists. When you arrive in Lothering, you find the place overrun with refugees escaping the Blight. Some jabronis try to extort money out of me, and it doesn't go well for them. This is one of those choices where it's really trying to test you. Are you such an opponent to unnecessary violence that you'll hand over your money? The answer is no, but it's a cool test of your resolve. Further into the town, you run into a trader who's gouging his prices in light of the difficult circumstances. So, as a Grey Warden, do I use my power to side with the common folk and make them charge a fair price, or do I side with the shopkeeper? I summon my inner Ayn Rand and say no! That merchant can charge what he likes. This is like the third or fourth choice in the game so far, and although I'm having fun slowly moulding my character, and don't get me wrong, the discount is nice, it's still not really of any consequence. still, the people are pissed and I can stock up on potions. And this town is about to be blighted anyway, so they're going to have a lot more to complain about pretty soon. In a local tavern, me and the boys run into an ex-rogue turned sister of the Chantry, basically this world's religious order, Leliana. She helps us to take out some guards from Denerim, who inform us that the Grey Wardens have been named as the ones responsible for the death of the king and the defeat at Ostagar. We make short work of them, and I decide to send one back with his tail between his legs and a message for Loghain. Running into way too many locked chests up until this point, I decide to take Leliana with us. In Lothering, there is another companion, but let's just say this one's a bit of a tougher sell. You find Sten, a member of the Canary race, locked in a cage, supposedly for the crime of murdering a woman and her children. The Chantry plan to leave Sten to the Darkspawn Horde after the town evacuates, which, in fairness to him, he doesn't seem too fazed by. Seeing the upsides to having such a beast of a man in our ranks, as well as, you know, just being a general fan of child murder, I convince the Reverend Mother to release him into my custody, on the condition that I be held responsible for anything he does wrong. Whew! Alright, we're at the end of the railroading. Everything after this point is far more open-ended. We have the choice to go to Redcliff and employ the redneck humans. We can go to the wilds to find the Dalish elves, the Circle of Magi to recruit the mages, or possibly back to Orzammar to get the dwarves on board. Not wanting to rock the boat too much after my exile, I decide to leave Orzammar until last. You know, just let things blow over. I mean, like, realistically, how long can someone be mad at you for fraternal regicide? So I decide to go to Redcliff to ask Arl Aemon for assistance. When you get to Redcliff, Arl Aemon agrees to help you without any problems or follow-up questions. You then have a lovely meal together and you sleep in a four-poster bed, waking up the next morning feeling refreshed and ready to take on the next adventure. Nah, I'm just kidding. There's Darkspawn fucking everywhere and the Arl is in a magic coma, locked in the castle, which is currently under demonic occupation. Just my luck, am I right? After convincing the blacksmith of the town to stand and fight with the rest of the civilians, in exchange for finding out if his daughter is still alive in the castle, which I, incidentally, forgot to do, we manage to repel the Darkspawn invasion and we make a plan to infiltrate the castle and see what's up with the Arl. So it turns out that the Arl's son Connor was a mage and his mother was keeping it a secret from the Circle in order to prevent them from taking him away. She employs a blood mage named Jowen to train her son in secret, which I may or may not have let out of prison because Grey Wardens do whatever we want, baby. Unfortunately, at some point, Connor lost control and became possessed, leading to the invasion and the current predicament. There are a plethora of options in how you can handle this. You can kill Connor, which is the easiest option, but although I previously expressed my interest in child murder, it's just no fun if it's for a good cause. And Sten doesn't even offer to do it, the useless git. Come on, man, this is supposed to be your favorite. The second option is to go see the Circle of Magi and see if they can help. Now, as a player, I know there's probably no time limit on this, but I like to roleplay. And the game presents this like it's a very urgent issue. We can't just leave a demon here to run amok while I go and sort out some random bullshit at the Mage's Tower. So I choose option 3. We sacrifice the child's mother and then use her blood for a ritual to send a mage into the Fade to drag Connor's soul back out. Oof, no one seemed to like that. So Morrigan kills the demon and manages to free the boy's soul, except Arl Aemon still hasn't woken up. Because it turns out he wasn't possessed or anything supernatural like that, Yeowen just poisoned him. Man, I was really trying to vouch for you here, buddy, but you make it hard for me to love you sometimes. That's fine, however, because there's an urn containing the ashes of the Prophet Andraste that the Chantry have been searching for, you know, centuries, so I'll just go find that and use its godlike powers to heal the Arl. Later. For now, let's go see what the elves are up to. When you arrive at the Dalish camp, you find that the group's hunters, basically their fighting force, have been attacked. Shit, I need those guys. Turns out they were attacked by werewolves, and the strange curse that makes the werewolves what they are has spread to them. If they don't receive help soon, they'll also become werewolves and lose their sanity. Clan leader Zathrian asks you to go into the forest and find a wolf known as Witherfang, who he claims is the progenitor of the curse and the leader of the werewolves. Before leaving, another one of the elves asks us to find his wife, who he claims was also attacked by the werewolves, but is still out there somewhere in the forests. As you travel through the woods, however, the werewolves gives you a number of chances to leave, saying that their problem lies with the elves and not with my party. It seems very considerate and diplomatic for a group of creatures that were just described to me as mindless feral savages. We eventually run into the wife of the trader from the camp. She's in the middle of her transformation into a werewolf, but she seems to have maintained some of her humanity. She tells you that the curse means a life of pain and asks you to put her out of her misery. I give her a quick death and promise to tell her husband she died for closure. These kinds of decisions always tug at my heartstrings for some reason. I don't know why mercy killings make me so emotional. Maybe it's the juxtaposition between the usually reprehensible act of killing someone and the relief of giving someone who's suffering some respite. Either way, this encounter leaves me emotionally drained, and as I venture forth, no longer really in a killing mood, I find myself with a new sense of sympathy for the werewolves. Eventually, we make it to the ruins that are supposed to house Witherfang. Once we reach her, she stops the other werewolves from tearing us limb from limb and tells us that she isn't actually a werewolf. She's actually the spirit of the very forest itself. It turns out that Zatrian cursed a group of men who lived in the woods and corrupted the spirit of the forest itself to do so. The men changed into beasts, spent the next century or so roaming the woods in agony, until Witherfang managed to unify them and get their animal instincts under control. Witherfang tells you to bring Zatrian to answer for his crimes. When you go upstairs, Zatrian is actually waiting for you at the entrance of the ruins, and my suspicion meter is through the roof at this point. I tell Zatrian to come talk to the werewolves, fully intending to take their side in this. But in a twist of George R.R. Martinian levels of fucked up, we eventually find out the full story of what happened between Zatrian and the humans centuries ago. Although it is true that Zatrian placed the curse on the men, his reasoning is beyond understandable. The werewolves were part of a human raiding party that killed his son and raped his daughter. She then committed suicide after finding out that she was left pregnant from the ordeal. In his anger, he turned to blood magic to bind the spirit of the forest to a wolf and set it upon the group of humans, infecting them with lycanthropy, and in turn made himself immortal until the curse ends. This means to end the curse, Zatrian has to die, and then you have to choose. Do you help the werewolves, who in life did some very questionable things, but have been suffering for centuries? But I'm also very sympathetic to Zathrian's plight, asking him to give up his life to save the lives of the men who caused him so much pain is a tough decision to make. They never really make it clear whether these are the original men or if these are the offspring of the men. It's not really made clear whether they've been reproducing this entire time or if they also have an unnaturally long life. And then there's also Witherfang to think of, who really is just an innocent bystander in all of this. There truly is no good choice here, only what you can convince yourself to be right. I decide to go with the werewolves, as a player think that this is the best choice for both parties. The werewolves can finally be free of their torture, and Zatrian can be at peace, and finally let go of all the pain and hatred that's been keeping him alive for centuries. Regardless of which side you pick, you get reinforcements to fight the Blight, but none of the options made me feel good about the outcome. Okay, next we're off to see the wizard. Hopefully this one will be a little bit chippier. The tower itself is on an island, and I have to be ferried across to the other side by this asshole.
You know, I have some documents too. They say I'm the Queen of Antiva. What do you think of that?
Being of actual noble descent, I threaten to tear him a new one if he doesn't allow me entrance, and we're off. When we get to the tower, we find they're in the middle of a predicament if you can Adam and Eve it. There's been another outbreak of demonic possession, and the Templars have locked all of the mages in the tower. Knight Commander Gregor of the Templars wants to enact a rite of annulment, basically an Order 66 for the mages, wiping them out to make sure that no demons manage to survive in the physical realm. I have the choice to either agree with the Templars and go in and wipe out the entire place, or try to find survivors before the rite of annulment is agreed upon by the officials in Denerim. This was a choice that looked like a simple moral conundrum on the face of it, with a right and wrong answer. You know, pick the genocide and you're the bad guy. Seems pretty straightforward. But this game doesn't really do black and white. And after seeing the effects that one mage getting possessed can have in Redcliffe, an entire circle of mages might be catastrophic. In some ways, the genocide was the safe choice here. So, with a lot more hesitation than I thought I'd have for such an issue, I ask for one chance to make things right, and I'm allowed to head into the tower to search for survivors. But if I don't come back with the first Enchanter Irving by the time the annulment is approved, they're coming in after us to finish the job. So we head inside and the door is locked behind us. Almost immediately we run into a senior mage named Wynn, who joins the party and finally my squad is complete! And with that, the Nella's angels start to fight their way through the tower. On one of the upper floors, we run into a Templar currently being mind-controlled by a demon. My first instinct is to attack, but I first ask what's happening. The demon is able to see the Templar's innermost desires, and she knows that he's unhappy with his vows to the Chantry. She creates an illusion in his mind of the life he wished he had. Wife, kids, the whole Ferelden dream. In return, all she wants is to be left alone with him, as being connected to him allows her to live in the mortal realm, where she claims things have more purpose and meaning. Again, this is another really complex issue for something that really only has two outcomes. Is it right to take away the happiness of this guy, even if it's all based on lies and coercion? And if I let them go, is there any real guarantee that this demon will keep her word and leave other people alone? I decide to take the American police force's approach of shoot first, apologize afterwards, and, you know, whatever happens, get off scot-free anyway. Unfortunately, killing the demon doesn't actually end the fight, and I'm forced to kill the Templar too. This was a really impactful decision to make, as it's really only my own personal outlook on life that says it's better to be dead than live a lie. But that guy didn't get to decide it for himself. Anyway, let's go on with the show. Eventually, you run into a demon who transports you into the Fade. Now, I have 2 hours of footage from this section, and I'm just gonna skip right over that whole fucking mess. No wonder there's a mod that literally just removes this section from the game. When you get back to the real world, you loot an item called the Litany of Adrala and head on. At the door to the top floor where the first Enchanter is being held hostage, a Templar informs us that a group of blood mages is attempting to have the circle all become possessed. He urges you to kill everyone on the top floor, as you can't tell a blood mage from a normal person, and they can invade your mind and control you. But thankfully, I have my super awesome Litany of Adrala, which protects me from such things. Has this ever happened to you? In the middle of a fight with some pesky blood mages, and you feel your mind slip away from you, your thoughts no longer your own? Well, with the Litany of Adrala, these problems are a thing of the past. Safe and easy to use, the Litany of Adrala can be applied directly to the temple for maximum effect. The Litany of Adrala is safe to use for most humanoid races. If you experience any problems while using the Litany of Adrala, please contact your local chantry. Litany of Adrala. Get out of my head and onto my sword. I eventually do what I came here to do and free the Circle Mages while wiping out the Blood Mages. In thanks, the mages agree to help us fight the Blight and Wynn joins the party full time. Oh, and we find Flemeth's Circle Mage Templar fanfiction or something lying around. The Templar was a really interesting area to explore, as most of the choices had a lot to consider based on not only the situation, but what you know about the lore. Had I come here before going to Redcliffe and not really known much about the Fade and how demons work, I may have made completely different choices, especially when deciding to let the demon go with her captive. There was a bunch of really deep philosophical questions about the nature of perception and reality, or the choices you need to make in such a dire, world-changing circumstance. Coming out of it with such a positive outcome made it feel like coming back from hell itself. The last place to visit is Orzammar, so I guess it's time for a homecoming. From the moment you set foot in Orzammar, there is tension in the air. Your brother Balin is fighting with some men who represent the local potential future king, Lord Harrowmount. You also find out very unceremoniously that the king is dead, seemingly from the grief of sending you into exile. Whew, okay. You can choose to side with either Harrowmont or, you know, if you're an idiot, go with Balin for some reason. This was obviously an easy choice for me to make, choose the person I know to be a treacherous usurper, or literally anyone else. But if I'd chosen a different origin story, it might have been more interesting. This is the first time my origin has given me insight into a situation that other paths wouldn't have. Maybe this would have been a harder choice if I'd not known what I did about this slimy little bastard. for some reason, being a Grey Warden, surviving in the Deep Roads by myself, and, you know, being my father's daughter, this isn't enough for my word to mean anything. So I have to go and do a bunch of meaningless tasks to show the Council I mean business. These tasks eventually lead me down into the Deep Roads again to find a Paragon who went missing about 2 years previously. A lady also asks me to find out what happened to her son, who is also down there somewhere. First of all, eventually you find what's left of her son, a broken shell of a man driven mad by having to survive down in the Deep Roads. With a little convincing, he tells us that he exiled himself after murdering someone over a dispute. Wroth with guilt, he asks me to lie to his mother and tell her he died, and she doesn't have to find out what happened. I reluctantly agree after failing to convince him to join us back to the surface. And I leave knowing his time is coming to an end, as either the Darkspawn or the Madness will eventually take him. Traveling on, we eventually manage to find the lost Paragon, Bronca. Her entire squad has either been killed or turned into Darkspawn, and she's not looking so good either. She came down here searching for the Anvil of the Void, a powerful magical object capable of creating golems. We agree to help her search for it if she'll come back and give Lord Harrowmont her recommendation. We also get a glimpse at the Darkspawn army and, oh god, oh fuck. We eventually find the chamber where the anvil is being protected by a small army of golems. The leader, who seems to be lucid and capable of communicating, tells us he used to be a paragon named Caradin, who went missing over 1,000 years ago.
If you seek the anvil, then you must care about my story.
Very presumptuous. He tells us that the anvil is here, but in order for it to work, you have to bind a living soul to make the golem. He intended to use it only on volunteers, but when his king began forcing people into the procedure, Caradin refused to work on it anymore and was turned into a golem himself. He asks you to help him destroy it since no golem can actually touch the anvil, which is, you know, super convenient plot-wise. Bronca then shows up and tells us to side with her, and that with the anvil, you can create an army of super golems that will not only crush the Darkspawn, but bring Orzammar back to its former glory. When I started this game, I had the idea of being a chaotic neutral sort of character, always choosing the most advantageous position in a given situation, you know, within reason. But the people I've encountered so far, as well as seeing how fucked up the city of Orzammar can get if left unchecked, I decide against it. Orzammar be damned. Bronca doesn't like this and attacks, using a control rod to force the other golems to help her. Once she's gone, we destroy the anvil and Caradin makes us a crown for us to give to our chosen candidate to rule Orzammar. And Caradin is then let rest. This crown is proof of his endorsement, and as a legendary paragon, his word is taken very seriously. We present the crown to Harrowmont, who is anointed king. Obviously, Joffrey I Dukin over here isn't too happy with this and attacks, which goes as well as you'd expect. And with that, we not only secure Harrowmont on the throne, but also ensure the inevitable rebellion from Baelin is quashed before it can begin. Before leaving, we tell Rook's mother he's dead, and that seems to bring her some closure. Picking the dwarf noble background gave me a very specific perspective on the Orzammar section of the game. It would have been pretty interesting to take Baelin's side anyway, to see how that changed him or affected the outcome, but you know, I'm not an idiot, so... Before we go to the Landsmeet, we have to get old Aemon back up on his feet again, so we have to go and get the Urn of Sacred Ashes. This was a really, really fun section of the game, full of world building and information about the life of Andraste, but narratively, not so much really goes on here, so just know that we find ashes, take ashes, and leave with ashes. Easy peasy. After Arl Aemon awakes from his coma, and is caught up on the boring details, we start to form our plan. It's at this moment that we find out that Alistair has been Caelan's half-brother this whole time and has the legitimate claim to the throne. This kind of annoyed me actually, because until now, there wasn't really any indication that Alistair was an important character. Because of this and because our classes overlapped, I never took him with me or spent any time developing our relationship in the game. So the attempt to make me sympathetic to his unwillingness to take the throne, it kind of fell short. There is another option though. We can rescue Queen Honora, the widow to the late King Caelan and the daughter of Taryn Loghain, and allow her to rule as queen. After rescuing her, she seems like a much more suitable leader. We persuade her to marry Alistair, as his royal right to the throne, as well as her leadership skills, would make them the greatest power couple since Sonny and Cher. Eventually, we either persuade or get rid of any of the nobles who would support Loghain over us. We confront Loghain at the Landsmeet, and he gives that cliche speech that all fantasy despots do about how he did what he thought was right, blah blah blah. At the end of the interaction, the court is split, so it's time to whip our dicks out for the measuring contest. When the fight starts going badly for him, Loghain challenges me to one-on-one combat because, you know, being a fantasy game, of course there's some law or rule that allows for combat to be a legitimate road to power. Once he's been neutralized, Loghain surrenders and accepts his faith, leaving you with three options this time. Kill Loghain yourself, you can let Alistair do it and take his revenge for Duncan's death, or let him live and force him to go through the joining. I didn't really buy his whole for the greater good speech, and even though I don't know him very well, Alistair didn't seem too keen on letting him join the Grey Wardens, so I let Alistair do the deed. Afterwards, unsurprisingly, Honora no longer wants to marry the man who just, you know, killed her father, so we have to decide who to put on the throne. Alistair really doesn't sell himself well, constantly saying how he's not made out to be a leader. So I take the super progressive position and let Honora be queen. Can you be progressive when you're instating feudalism? Yeah, it doesn't matter. Now, finally, time to tie up some loose ends and finish this. Remember that Diary of Flemeth I mentioned earlier? Well, it turns out it's not only not full of intense Templar on Mage fanfiction, known to us connoisseurs as Ping, it's also fake. Morrigan claims that Flemeth wants to kill her when she becomes powerful enough in order to take over her body. This is apparently how Flemeth has stayed alive for so long and become the thing of legends, having daughters waiting for them to mature and then taking over their bodies once they're ripe, I suppose. It's kind of a weird word to use. Morrigan asks us to kill Flemeth for her and to get the real grimoire so that she can study it and learn Flemeth's secrets. When we get there, Flemeth seems to know why we're here. She tells us to go get the grimoire and to just let her live. I expected her to be more defensive, being such a powerful mage, but her willingness to comply persuades me not to fight her. The night before the final battle, another warden named Reardon takes myself and Alistair aside and tells us the uncomfortable truth about killing the Archdemon. Reardon showed up late into the game, and he assumed myself and Alistair were experienced wardens who knew about the risk. In order to fully destroy the Archdemon, someone with the Darkspawn taint must deal the final blow, allowing the soul of the Archdemon to enter their body, and as a result, both get destroyed. Reardon volunteers as the senior Grey Warden of the party to be the sacrifice, and never passing up an opportunity to, you know, not have to die, I agree. Somewhat of a shitty choice to make, but in the end, what's one more sacrifice in all of this chaos? So a somber inevitability to ponder the night before the final march. But Morrigan claims to have another way. A sexier way. Morrigan's got that baby fever, and she wants that princely Alistair dick. Kind of. After researching Flemeth's book, she discovers that if she conceives a child with someone who has the Darkspawn taint, the Archdemon's soul can transfer to the fetus, meaning that nobody has to die. She assures me this is a way to cleanse the Archdemon's soul, and that the child will be more akin to one of the Elder Gods than a demon. Her only caveat is that once it's done, she's leaving with the child and asks not to be followed. And it has to be Alistair who does the Crowley in her Bowley. This is a problem as apparently they don't like each other, which again I missed out on because I never took Alistair on missions. A little hint that he was going to be this important to the ending of the game would have been really nice. I agreed to let Morrigan have her weird archdemon child. Until now, I didn't really know how to feel about Morrigan. Her views on the situations that arose throughout the game weren't evil, but she does have a very everyone for themselves, only the strong deserve to live kind of attitude. But I also don't know why she'd lie to me about this, and the way she opened up to me about her mother and not wanting to be Flemeth's vessel made me really feel for her. Let's hope I was right. The final battle takes place in Denerim, as the Horde is laying waste to the entire city, and the Archdemon is flying off in the distance, conveniently circling a nearby tower. You have to choose for the final time who you'll take into combat with you as you fight your way through the tower, with everyone you don't choose staying behind to defend the gates. For some players, this might be a tough choice, but if you're like me and played through the entire game with essentially the same team, it's not as impactful. It also made the short section where you control the B team fall really flat. And not just because I had to quickly level up everyone and equip them with any leftover weapons and armor I had floating in my inventory. Anyway, enough of the B team and back to the A team. We finally get to see what all the hard work has been for. This wheel over here, where you can choose which army from the ones you've convinced to help you in a particular fight. It was cool to see the warriors from the Dalish camp or the mages take to the battlefield, but it would have been cooler if they had a more recognizable leader maybe, who I could associate them with. In the distance, we see Reardon almost kill the archdemon but ultimately fall to his death. I don't know if this would have happened if I hadn't chosen to go through with the ritual, but it seems like a cheap way to force me to choose between myself or Alistair at the end had I not. Atop the tower, we corner the demon and, in easily the most tense fight in the game, the archdemon eventually goes down. When the dust clears, Morrigan is gone and the darkspawn retreat. We then get one last chance to talk to all of our companions, and the game ends with written segments about the outcomes of each of the characters and cities that you encountered along the way. Or at least that's what would have happened if my game didn't decide to crash right about there. But that actually wasn't too important to me, as I'm more interested in the in-game effects you have, not some inconsequential epilogue. Let's go into how Dragon Age mostly succeeds at this and go through some of the failings in its systems. For choices to be meaningful in a game, they have to have some kind of consequence, whether that be a tangible effect or outcome, or a more personal one. Dragon Age Origins succeeds at the latter but falls short of the former. For example, no matter which of the origins you choose from, it pretty much always ends with you being banished, exiled, or in some way forced from your home to join the Grey Wardens. None of the origins really have like a noble call to arms, every origin is set up to be a reluctant hero. The same unfortunately goes for many of the main story beats in the game. Regardless of how you handle the situation in each of the four main cities that you go to for help, you're going to come away with someone to aid you. Whether you side with the werewolves or the elves, you'll have a slot filled in the wheel at the final fight. It can be very risky to have a definitive fail state in such a long and epic game like this, but if there was an option to completely bungle up every encounter you had to the point where you raise no army for the final fight, or have a severely diminished fighting force, it would have made your actions have so much more weight. If a choice has many outcomes, but none of those outcomes are failure, then really you're just choosing which brand of success you think is more in character for you. The only choice I felt had the potential for a true impact on the story was the final decision of who to let die once the archdemon was slain. Again though, I really feel this choice would have been better if I had a closer relationship with Alistair. If I hadn't stumbled across Flemeth's grimoire and initiated the quest to perform the dark ritual on Morrigan's baby, it could have been a really difficult choice to make, especially in the heat of the battle. And I didn't feel like the dark ritual was a cop-out, especially considering Morrigan leaves the party if you refuse. But once it's proposed, it becomes the ideal choice, making it hard not to choose it.
You will not hate this quite so much as you believe.
And really, no matter which you decide, the game will still end with the archdemon being destroyed. With the constant looming threat of the Blight and the random attacks on humanity, imagine instead if the developers had taken an approach similar to XCOM 2. I know that game came out years after Dragon Age Origins, but just hear me out. If the Blight was more of an ever-present threat mechanically, it might help with the sense of urgency and give your choices more weight. After you leave Lothering, you can't return as the place has been overrun, but you can then spend weeks travelling back and forth between Ferelden without the Horde ever advancing further. You can take your time to gather your armies and prepare well for the attack. It also doesn't help that so many characters go on about how urgent all of this is. But it's hard to feel that way when you can just travel back and forth and back and forth as many times as you want. An XCOM 2 Annihilation counter could do so much for this. It would force you to make meaningful choices about who to try to save and go to for help. For example, going to Redcliff first might reveal that the Blight is on its way there soon, meaning that you have to choose between going to get the ashes for Arl Aemon or going to the Circle to recruit the mages, as the Blight engulfs the entire southern section of the map. The urgency would add to the desperation of the entire endeavor, and your choices would have much longer lasting consequences. Another system that fails to hold you accountable is the companion system. Whenever you make a controversial choice, certain characters will either approve or disapprove depending on their outlook. Sten and Morrigan, for example, would often be displeased if I took a detour to help someone non-essential, while characters like Wynn and Leliana would approve. The idea is that if you go against the wishes of a party member enough, they would get fed up and just leave the party. All the bonds you had with them, the time you spent, and all the gear you gave them would be gone, just like that. Except there is an easy and cheap way to circumvent this through giving your companions gifts while at camp. The idea that Alistair would be so annoyed at me for sacrificing Isilda or whatever her name is at Redcliffe that he disapproved once when I made the decision even though he wasn't there, and again when I talked to him about it at camp, only to come around to me for giving him a shiny necklace or some bullshit, completely removes the tension between the characters. You no longer have to worry about balancing the desires of multiple complex characters with their own motivations in order to keep this motley crew together at all costs for the greater good. You just give people gifts or money and then all is forgiven. Maybe this game is more realistic than I thought. But that's enough harping on about the bad side. Let's talk about what Dragon Age Origins gets right in its choice systems. Throughout the game, the player has to make many ambiguous choices that allow you to express the kind of person your character is. Even though many of these choices don't really have a direct effect on any outcomes in the game, they are there to allow the player to roleplay their character, and any emotional response they glean from their actions can be very powerful. For example, telling Rook's mother that her son was dead, essentially lying to spare her feelings in a perverse way, was quite heart-wrenching. The choice has no effect on the story, in fact I think her character model disappears from the game once the quest finishes, but it's still a story where you can sympathize with all the characters involved. And there are plenty of moments just like this throughout the game. At the start, when I was in Ostagar, you find out that the generals are having a meeting in a tent within the camp. I failed my persuasion check to get in, but being a noble, I still managed to blag my way inside, giving it a very personal touch. One thing I really liked was the lack of a karma meter or some such indication of how good or evil you were. This isn't really a game about black and white morality, and the effects of your actions are portrayed through the ways in which the characters treat you. This is a far better indicator of where you stand morally in this bleak and unforgiving setting. When kindly old Wynn is chastising you over your decision, it has more gravity than some numbers going up on a bar or beginning to see horns sprout from your head or something else. To get the most from Dragon Age Origins, you need to fully commit to roleplaying and embody your character. Sometimes this means imagining the repercussions of your actions. Maybe all of the inconsequential side characters are interacted with have their stories wrapped up in the epilogue, but that's kind of a cheap way out. I would much rather see the effects in-game than just read it from some list. All in all, Dragon Age Origins does a good job of delivering gut-wrenching blows, but the consequences that you face are usually more personal than narrative-driven, which is a disappointment. If linear stories are described as railroads, forcing you down a single track with no way off, then the decisions you have to make in Dragon Age Origins are like junctions. You can change the rail so that you end up at a different platform of the station, but the stations are all the same, the destination is the same, and the sections between platforms all converge back to a single line. To bring this back to my previous video on BioShock, which you should totally check out by the way, about how a linear story highlighted the lack of agency in video games, this game about player choice also manages to inadvertently reinforce this idea. Whether this is just a limitation of our ability to program and develop a multitude of outcomes to scenarios, or a misunderstanding of what makes a choice worth making in a game like this, is hard to tell. Personally, I think we won't have this kind of robust decision-making in a game until AI is able to dynamically react to our choices in a complex way. Overall though, I enjoyed my time in Theatis. The moral ambiguity of most of the choices, and the chance to truly build the kind of character I wanted to be, was nice, even if I'm the only person who really knows what happened to most of the auxiliary characters. Maybe one day I'll reboot up the game and finish the last fight again just to see the epilogue, but for now I'm happy with what my imagination has left me with. And with that we come to the end of another Steam Pilgrimage episode. I really hope that you've enjoyed. If you made it all the way to the end, props to you. Maybe you'll consider liking and sharing this video, and maybe if you really liked it and you want to see more when it comes out, you can subscribe down below and hit the bell notification button. This video took a while to make, as you can see it's a much longer video than usual. If you liked this new longer form kind of content, please let me know down in the comments, as I've been thinking for quite a while to shift the tone of this channel into more long form video essays. Thank you so much for watching, and as always, keep hacking away at that backlog.